Good afternoon and welcome to this service to celebrate the life and faith of Sandie Feldcamp. A warm welcome to all who are here in the sanctuary and a special welcome to those who are joining online on YouTube, whether on this Sunday afternoon or at some future time. I know there are some from Winnipeg and such that are planning to join, so welcome. It is good to be here, and we offer a special welcome to Sandie's family, and it's good to be together so that we can celebrate her life and give thanks to God for her. I'm Gail McDonald, the minister here at Clarkson Road, and it is my honor on behalf of the people of Clarkson Road to welcome all here. Sandie was a beloved member of this community of faith. COVID has changed so many things about how we do life and how we go about things, and grief and the way that we honor those who have passed is no exception to that. And I'd just like to say it makes us all really sad that we can't do some of the rituals and some of the being together that we would like to do. But I'm glad we're doing this in November of 2021 and not last February or January, because we wouldn't even be here in this place. So we give thanks for small mercies while recognizing how hard it is to not be able to do the ritual things that we like to do to help show our support to all who are grieving. We have a tradition here at Clarkson Road Presbyterian Church, and we light the Christ candle at the beginning of all of our services. We do this because Jesus said, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." And we believe that Christ continues to be with us and that Christ's light continues to shine in the world. And Jesus chooses all of us to be the ones to take that light into the world. And a small little crack of light can make such a difference in the darkness. We've come together today, united by sorrow, affection, and hope. We've come together to give thanks for the life of Sandie Feldcamp, to remember all the ways in which her life touched ours, and to honor her faith. We've also come to share in the sorrow of those who mourn, and to offer them our love and our support. And we are here to bear witness to our faith in Jesus Christ, who said, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live, and everyone who lives and believes in me will never die." With faith in Christ, let us lift up our hearts to God, that the Lord may bless us in this time with strength and with peace. I share these words now from Psalm 121 as our call to worship. I lift my eyes to the hills. From where will my help come? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. He will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. He who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in from this time on and forevermore. Let's pray together. Creating God, we thank you because you made us in your very own image and gave us gifts of mind, body, and spirit. We thank you for Sandie, for all that made Sandie who Sandie was. And we're grateful for what she meant to each of us. As we honor her memory in our time together today, make us more aware that you are the one from whom comes every perfect gift, including the gift of eternal life through Jesus Christ. Your love is steadfast and true, and we offer our gratitude for the ways that you have comforted us and been present to those who are mourning. We ask your blessing on our time together as we remember and give thanks for Sandie's life. In your loving mercy, we place our trust through Jesus Christ, our Lord, in whose name we pray. Amen. Now, Sandie didn't do a lot of planning or talking about this day. She was prepared to go, but she didn't do a lot of planning or talking about this day. But when Lynn and I were talking about what she might like for the service, she had a hymn, and we are going to sing it first. How Great Thou Art. And so I invite you, you're welcome to stand. We've got our masks on, so you're welcome to sing here. And if you're watching at home, you can sing out loud and join in. Let's sing together, How Great Thou Art. I scarce can take it in. What a gorgeous way to begin this service. Part of grieving is remembering and giving thanks and sharing stories and reflections. I'd like to invite Lynn to come up first and to share with us.
Sandie's sister-in-law. I wasn't going to do this. Sandra Lee Feldcamp was born in Toronto on January 12, 1946, to Maureen Nee Robertson and John, known as Jack, Feldcamp. Much of Sandie's life is a mystery to us. Her life wasn't a very happy one by her accounts. At the very tender age of 17 months, she was apprehended along with her younger brother, Don, by CAS, and she was placed in foster care. Unfortunately, Sandie's life in foster care was fraught with unhappiness. She was not encouraged to become everything God had intended for her to be, and stayed with that foster family only until she was old enough to leave. Her education ended in the eighth grade, which made it difficult for her to navigate life. She did the best she could with the resources she had. After many years of searching by members of her biological family, on July 13th, 2017, at 9:40 p.m. Central Daylight Time, Sandie answered a phone call from a number she didn't recognize, which she didn't normally do, that would drastically change her life. It is a conversation and a day that will forever be etched in my memory. It was the day that Sandie found a real family, one connected by DNA. After 70 years, she learned for the first time that she wasn't alone in the world. She had two brothers, one of whom we are still searching for. When asked why she'd answered that particular call, her response was, and I quote her, "I figured if someone called me that many times, 9 or 10, in one day, it must be something important." She was so shocked with this new revelation, it took her several months to process the information in her mind. Each time we'd talk on the phone, we'd ask if she had told her friends at church her news yet. She'd say, "No, I'm still trying to wrap my head around it." We had hoped to move Sandie to Winnipeg since we knew that her health was waning. Unfortunately, before we could even begin the serious research needed to figure out how such a move could be facilitated, COVID hit. With all the restrictions in place, Sandie's physical contact with her friends was greatly impacted. Her ability to adequately care for herself failed, and her health declined. In May 2021, thanks to her very good friends Christine Scotland and Kelta Fleck, a wellness check was initiated when Sandie didn't return their phone calls. Sandie was often prone to ignoring her messages on her answering machine, and this wasn't the first time a wellness check was being done on her. Don and I had called for one at one time as well. I think Sandie found some humor in that one. This time, however, the outcome was serious. Sandie was transported to the Trillium Health Center, where it was discovered that she had lung cancer along with other health issues. She spent a couple of months there before being transferred to the Reactive Care Center in Toronto while she waited for placement in a long-term care facility. On July 20th, 2021, Sandie was transferred to the Avalon Care Center in Orangeville, where she'd be closer to family members. On Saturday, November 13th, 2021, Sandie was taken to the Headwaters Healthcare Center in Orangeville in respiratory distress. She passed away peacefully at the age of 75 on Sunday, November 14th, 2021, with Liz Van Gerven by her side. Sandie was the beloved sister of Donald Parks, married to Linda, dear niece of Norma Wiles, Nee Robertson, loving aunt to Wendy Wilson, Daryl, and cousin to Geraldine Van Gerven and Peter, Connie Burbage, and Scott, Vicki Snudden and Russell, Debbie Rao and Jim,
and Loretta Weller and Butch, most of whom she was never able to meet. Sandie was preceded in death by her birth parents, Maureen Nee Robertson, and John, known as Jack Feldcamp. She will be fondly remembered by her many friends at Clarkson Road Presbyterian Church in Mississauga, who became like family to her, and where she loved to care for her children in the nursery on Sundays. The family wishes to thank all the doctors and caregivers she had in the Trillium Health Center in Mississauga, the Reactive Care Center in Toronto, the Avalon Care Center, and Headwaters Healthcare Center, both in Orangeville. A very special thank you to Liz Van Gerven for all you did for Sandie over the past number of years when we couldn't be there for her and stepping up to be the POA for her. Another special thank you to the friends of CRPC who were like family to her in the absence of bio family, and to those who visited, called, and sent cards while Sandie was in the Avalon Care Center. A celebration of Sandie's life will be held at 2 p.m. on Sunday, November 21st, 2021, at the Clarkson Road Presbyterian Church, 1338 Clarkson Road North, Mississauga, Ontario. Interment will take place later in Manitoba. In lieu of flowers, donations may be made in Sandie's memory to Clarkson Road Presbyterian Church at the address above.
Special time when Sandie was able to finally share with us that family had found her and that she had family, and after, I'm sure we'll hear more about it later, but after her trip, she was so excited. So thank you for sharing that. Kelta, would you come and share your reflections, please?
Hello, my name is Kelta Fleck. I'm a member of Clarkson Road Church here, and I would like to speak on behalf of all of the congregation, because I can vouch for the fact that absolutely everyone who is here has played a very important role in Sandie's life and friendships here at this church. And I'd like to say, actually, before I start, one very special guest here today is Oriana. And Oriana was one of Sandie's, you're not supposed to have favorites in the nursery, but I know that she was special even at her first birthday party. And today Oriana is actually wearing the pendant that Sandie's wearing in this picture. So thank you, Oriana, for coming and representing so many of the children that passed through the nursery. So I'd like to start with what I wrote, written here. I'd like to speak on behalf of the whole congregation at Clarkson Road Church, because Sandie's been a part of the family for over 15 years. She came to the church with a Scottish lady named Margaret, whom she roomed with in a townhouse in Barsuda Drive. And over the years, I've come to wonder about Margaret. Was she really Sandie's guardian angel? Because nobody seems to remember when Margaret started coming here, and Margaret died very shortly after that day that Sandie showed up here. And Clarkson Road sort of adopted Sandie. She shared some of her sad history with us, but soon she allowed us to become her trusted friends, her family, her support group. And collectively, and I do mean collectively, we worked to find her a new apartment, to get her set up for some independent living. The dentist, the doctor, the banking, the furniture for her home, all of those things. But I would say one of the things that really connected Sandie to the world around her were all the rides that people supplied. It was never any problem for people to come, and they came from Brampton, they came from Oakville, wherever, to pick her up, to bring her, to make sure that she was a part of everything that happened here. The one thing that really opened the door, I think, for Sandie to share who she was and how she felt about things was when she started to work with Pat McLean in our church nursery. And I think that was back about 2003 or so. She loved that job, and she rarely missed a Sunday. The kids loved her, and they knew that she loved them. Over the years, Sandie'd been treated to all kinds of activities. She'd been invited to lunch with lots of people. I know there were groups of ladies that would invite her to performances at the Meadowvale Theater. I know that she had her first trip to Niagara Falls from another member here, and the thrill that she had of seeing one of the wonders of the world was just amazing for her. She had other fun outings. People came and took her for drives to see the wonderful flowers in the summertime, the fall colors in the winter, and the Christmas lights in all through Mississauga. And Sandie liked to go on all of these things, and she appreciated the time that people spent with her. And she liked to come with me, too, when we went to visit some of our homebound members. Sandie often celebrated the special holidays with different families, and faithfully was invited for lunch after church. And Sandie loved going to Arda and Siam's house because their dog, Russell, would always wag his tail and so happy because Sandie was going to take him for a long walk after lunch. And Arda also took Sandie every month to the Christian women's meetings. And to start with, I think it was the free muffins and coffee that said, oh yeah, I'll go back next month. But she really did miss them and was sad when Arda wasn't allowed to drive any longer. Sandie always enjoyed being part of the activities here, whether it was Sundays, which means instead of just getting coffee and cookies, we actually had a table set up with ice cream and all the sprinkles and everything. So that was a good day for her. She poured the coffee sometimes at the coffee hour. She also was here when after our bowling parties or our skating parties. She always loved to be a part of all that. Of course, the potluck suppers, the ladies' Christmas potluck luncheon, and gift exchange. And as some will know, when that first time happened, when you get your name, your card called, you pick a gift, and then the next person can actually come and take yours or get another one. So there was a little explaining about, you'll still get a prize at the end. There'll be a present. So there were some things like that. Of course, the pancake breakfast, our game tonight, burn supper, and special evening galas and concerts. Sandie never missed one. Somebody, unbeknownst to any of the rest of us, treated her to some of these things, and someone always went to pick her up. And she never, ever missed a Sunday school picnic on the front lawn. She had lots of friends here, as you can see by the ones that have come today, and I'm thrilled to see how many. Lots of friends. And for several years, Sandie came to the monthly prayer meeting before church. She was part of the ladies' Bible study for a season or two, and she played a very active role in our monthly worship service at Mississauga Long-Term Care Home on Peter Street. And she even invited her good friend and neighbor, Mike Porch, to join us. Mike was good fun, he loved to sing, and they were a good support for each other. She was also active and participated in the Mississauga Seniors Group at South Common Community Center, where she enjoyed the bi-weekly meetings and special outings. She was especially proud when she and Mike won the best costumes at their Halloween party. And if you stop by this table, you will see the two of them dressed for that Halloween party. One of the other highlights in Sandie's life was that when Mike's family invited her to join them in the Dominican Republic to celebrate their grandson's wedding. And here again, the church family was ready and willing to help Sandie prepare for this big occasion. She had never lived the life of leisure, so there was some etiquette to share with her about you shower, you get dressed, you hang out, you go and eat, and you drink, and you be merry, and then you come back, and you shower again, and you change into something nice to go for dinner, and you eat and drink and be merry even more. So being in the situation she was in, we could tell that perhaps a wardrobe assistance might not hurt. So again, I can look out here and I can say, I know she had this lovely dress to wear to the wedding, thanks to one, and other summer dresses, thanks to others. The one thing we couldn't do, though, was help her with her shoes. Sandy had challenging feet. So otherwise, so when it was time to go for this adventure, because she'd never been on a plane, she'd never been in a fancy resort, she'd never even been at a wedding. And so for us to be a part of this new adventure was really special for us. And to see that big smile on her face when she tried on the new fancy clothes she'd be taking, we could see her relax and look forward to that adventure. And she was still smiling when we saw the pictures when she came back. Being found by her brother Don and his wife Lynn from Winnipeg was a shock, but a very, very pleasant, life-changing event. And as Lynn said, for 70 years, Sandy never knew that there was anybody out there that cared for her. What a godsend you have been. And on behalf of her church family here, thank you so much. And I won't go over what Lynn already said, but a special thanks to Liz, who not only saw that Sandy got organized in the place, she kept an excellent watch on her. She was so well cared for. Liz did shopping so that she had nice clothes, nice bright colors on, got her hair done. She decorated her room, really. It was just so lovely that you have been a part of her life, even for a short time. Okay, as the years passed and Sandy's health and mobility became compromised, in 2018, sadly, she had to retire from her beloved nursery. And retirement can be a difficult time for any of us. But Sandy really struggled with her sense of purpose here at Clarkson. And then the coronavirus spread into a pandemic, and all of our lives became very restricted. And during that time, Mike died, and her health really deteriorated. And sadness upon sadness wore her down. I'm just really thankful that Marion and I and Maureen went to visit her. And on that Wednesday before she died last Sunday, she was very frail, but always happy to see us and to hear about her friends at Clarkson. She was very peaceful, and she wasn't afraid. We talked about this, and she knew that Jesus loved her, and he was ready for her to come to heaven. We closed our visit with our usual prayer, and as we were leaving, she smiled and raised her hand from under the covers and waved goodbye. So on behalf of the whole Clarkson Road Church family, I can honestly say, we are thankful and honored to have been accepted as friends by Sandy and to have had the privilege to experience her courage, her strength, her faith, and her faithfulness. She will be missed, but not forgotten.
Thank you, Kelta. Sandy had such a wide-reaching impact on so many people here, and it just the stories keep coming out, and very profound. She was a gift. Dawn, would you come and share now, please?
It's quite a revelation to be almost 70 years old and find out that you actually have a sister. And it was an amazing time for both of us. And Sandie did not always express herself easily. But when we were able to bring her out to Winnipeg, we were able to, my wife took her out and was able to give her pedicures and manicures, and she had never experienced that type of thing. We took her to a Chinese restaurant. She had never been to a Chinese restaurant. She was having foods that she had never had the privilege of having. The simple things of life that you and I would take for granted was all amazing and a revelation to her. It was something else to see. We enjoyed the time immensely, and I think she did too. COVID made things very difficult for us. I can only imagine people that have lost loved ones and could not say goodbye. It must be exceedingly heartbreaking for that to occur. Thanks to a lot of people, Sandie didn't have to pass away alone. She was surrounded by friends from people of this congregation. It could have been far different, and yet people that, like I say, from this congregation, those people that drove her to and from church, the people that visited her in Mississauga, the people that drove all the way out to Orangeville to visit, and of course, the wonderful lady that sat with her for practically the whole day when she passed away. All these things made the ending, I don't view it as being sad so much as I think I'm grateful. I'm grateful that she found that she had family. I'm grateful that she did not pass alone. I'm grateful for the numerous people from this congregation and community and in Orangeville that made her life more comfortable and made the journey home easier. We are extremely grateful, and most of all, I am grateful to our Lord and Savior, because now Sandie has the hope of a resurrection to be with our Lord, and I think that's the greatest miracle of all. So it's not a terrible time for us. I think it's a time to be very grateful for Sandie and very grateful to a lot of people that, like I say, made her life more comfortable and not to be alone at the end.
Thank you, Dawn. Sandie had the gift of her chosen family, Clarkson Road. Not sure who chose who, but it became this chosen family, and then to have the gift of finding her biological family and having those connections. She was blessed in that way. Sandie's faith was important to her, and I want to read a couple of scriptures for us now. The first is familiar to us, Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Such a profound psalm, as it captures our faith and what it is to go through life with a shepherd in all circumstances. And Lynn suggested another passage for us that comes from Matthew's gospel. And it speaks of just how compassionate and loving Jesus, the Good Shepherd, is. I'm reading from the 11th chapter, verses 28 to 30. Come to me, all you that are weary and carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. As we heard Kelta say, Sandie loved children. She spent so many years in the nursery, caring for them, loving them. And as I had a few emails this week saying that even though she didn't have her own children, she had her own children at Clarkson Road. Countless children got their start in church in Sandie's arms. In her arms and in the arms of those who were partners with her in the nursery caring for them. As the children grew and were able to walk and then run, they knew exactly where to go, where they could find safety, someone who was excited to see them and who loved them and cared for them. Sandie was that constant presence for them here at the church. Often on Sunday mornings, Sandie would be standing guard at the church door out here waiting for children to be coming. And I would be standing greeting people by this main doorway here or by my office door, and we had lots of opportunities to chat as the time went by. She would say, do you think so-and-so is coming today? Do you think so-and-so is coming? And Stuart and I would bring our grandson periodically to church with us. He lives out of town, but he would come for the weekend, and she'd always look forward to having him in the nursery, and she'd say to me, is my little buddy coming? When is my little buddy coming back to church? I want to play with him. The depth of her care for the kids was so evident, and the joy that they brought her was evident, and those relationships grew as the kids grew and they continued to talk to her. And they expanded to the parents and the grandparents, and people took good care of Sandie, and those relationships and friendships were there. When Liz called me last Saturday and told me that Sandie was being moved into palliative care and didn't have long to live, I got thinking back to Sandie and my time with her and her time here at the church, and memories of her waiting for the kids and talking about the kids and remembering the kids from long ago, and when she'd see them towering over me and she'd say, "I remember when they were little." Passage came to mind for me about Jesus and children. Jesus knew the value of children, and he loved them, and he just knew how important it was to make them feel loved and welcomed, as did Sandie. I want to read to you now from Luke chapter 15, verses 15 to 17. Many of you will remember this scene from your Sunday school days. I remember, I'm going to age myself, I remember the felt, the flannel felt pictures of this story being up, and my image of Jesus was very much shaped by this story. People were bringing even infants to him that they might touch him. And when the disciples saw it, they sternly ordered them not to do it. But Jesus called to them and said, "Let the little children come to me, and do not stop them, for it is to such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly, I tell you," Jesus said, "whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it." Disciples had one thing in mind, and Jesus was really not having that. He didn't care about the time schedule or what was on. The kids were important to him. Jesus came for absolutely everyone, and he wanted everyone to feel welcome and that they had a place from the time they were born to the time they died. To be a truly welcoming community of faith, this welcome has to start with the very young and their parents. Getting to church on a Sunday morning when you've got little ones, probably one of the more difficult things in the world to do, because they actually don't care that church starts at 10:30. So to get them here can be an accomplishment some days. But to see Sandie there, excited to see them, and to have that welcome, and for parents to know, "My child, my children are looked after for the next hour, and my job is to sit in this pew and worship God, and it's about me and God for an hour." It's an incredible, incredible gift. Sandie helped to give this welcome to those kids and to the parents. And she experienced the welcome and the love of this community of faith. And as is said, in many ways, it became family. The people of Clarkson Road lived out the gospel by the way they connected with Sandie, the way they cared for her and built relationship with her. And they embraced her and gave her the opportunity to play a really pivotal role in the ministry that goes on here. They gave her purpose and dignity. It was not a looking down upon, there was a connection, a genuine love. I've heard stories over the years and more in this last week of the many, many connections and the ways that Sandie was welcomed in to every aspect of life here, as Kelta alluded to and gave us so many examples of. She was not left out of anything, but she was also included in lunches at homes, in birthday parties, in various celebrations. There were always friends to talk to her after church in coffee time. I know that Sandie felt the love of this community of faith, and that is something that we give thanks for, that she was willing to let people in and to help her and to do that, and we benefit from that. When Sandie found out that she had cancer, we talked about her faith, we talked about how she was feeling about it. Never a woman for many words, she did express her. When I asked about her faith, she felt confident in it. She felt that she was connected to Jesus. She felt Christ's love being shared with her. And she told me that she wasn't afraid to die. She believed. She believed that in death there was new life with Jesus. One of the things that she loved to do was pray. And I know those who visited her regularly had that experience of being able to pray with her, and I prayed with her many times on the phone, and last Saturday Liz called a couple of times, and I was able to pray with her, and knowing that her time was coming very soon when she would make the passage from this life into the next life, and so we were able to pray that Jesus would help make that easy and that he would be there to welcome her on the other side. She couldn't speak at that time, but it was really quite profound to hear her breathing change. I believe that she felt God's Spirit. And as we prayed, she knew that it was okay, that her faith was real. Beautiful to witness someone have that trust and faith in Jesus and to face the end of their earthly life in that way. May we all know this peace and have the confidence in life after death. Rest well, dear Sandie, rest well. We have another old favorite hymn to sing, The Old Rugged Cross.
And I'm
invite you to pray with me. Eternal and ever merciful God, you are always near to us. Help us to draw near to you, trusting that nothing can separate us from your steadfast love. We come to you through Christ our Lord, who said, "Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted." In this and every hour, help us to know your presence and protection. Kindle anew the hope that death is swallowed up in victory, and that because you live, we also live. Help us to hold on to and be inspired by the hope that comes from you. Oh God, we give you thanks for Sandie, for her life, and for all of our relationships with her. Thank you for all that she meant to this community of faith and the people here. God, we are so grateful that you were able to help reunite her with biological family and giving her that sense of connection and comfort and peace, knowing that they were there. And we're so grateful that there was some time where they got to know one another and build relationships. God, we are so thankful for everyone who took the time and the care to call Sandie, to send her cards, and to go visit her, especially in these last months when she's been ill. She developed some really special friendships, and we're grateful for all those people. We give you thanks, O God, that Sandie is at peace and has entered into the new life which you have prepared for those that love you. We pray for all who grieve, asking you to comfort them in their grief. Help them to know your peace and your love and your presence. We ask these things through Jesus Christ, our Lord, and we pray now as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We have one final hymn to sing, and I'm going to invite you to remain standing at the end of this hymn. It is well with my soul.
When peace lies.
are going to take the urn with Sandie's remains back to Winnipeg with them, where she'll be laid to rest. And in preparation for that, we are going to release Sandie into God's care. In the sure and certain hope of the resurrection to eternal life through Christ our Lord, we release Sandie Feldcamp to the mercies of Almighty God. Blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. They rest from their labors, and their deeds follow them. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord be kind and gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Reach out to